300 years ago, Britain was just beginning to become the workshop of the world. Our textiles, timepieces, and guns were famous throughout Europe. And as trade expanded, more people joined the ranks of the super rich.
The British acquired a new reputation during these years for wealth and lavish expenditure on old master paintings that flooded into the country from the continent and on a whole range of precious objects, trinkets. And one of the most important conspicuous consumers was Frederick, Prince of Wales.
The Royal Collection has a number of items of exceptional workmanship and delicacy, which give us an insight into Georgian fashionable taste.
Catherine, what an amazing display. Tell us about these things.
Well, you can see here a rather interesting assortment of objects that of the type that Frederick, Prince of Wales purchased. So among them we have a number of snuff boxes. Taking snuff was a great Georgian occupation.
Sniffing tobacco powder?
That's right. They all have to be very firmly hinged. Obviously, you have to keep your snuff dry, but very much designed to sit in your hand, so very carefully designed. But some of these are actually, they're not for snuff, they're actually of use, so they do actually contain, either in this case we've got perfume bottles, or some of them have small objects of almost like a little toolkit.
Wow.
So you can see this one's got sort of tweezers and
small thing for getting stains out of horses' hooves.
Yeah. Exactly, it's your early version of a
Swiss Army knife. So it's an ostentatious accessory. Would that be how you'd
very much use? So? Particularly the ones that we know belong to Frederick are of particularly high quality. We know he spent over £700 in a single visit to a shop that sold this type of item. So it gives a good idea of what sort of things he had.
Music and theatre gave Georgians a chance to climb the social ladder outside the formality of the court. Frederick, an accomplished musician, used these same things as a means of increasing his influence. I've come to Kew Palace to meet Robert Woolley, who is putting one of Frederick's most revealing purchases through its paces. Robert, most of us are familiar with piano as a keyboard instrument. What's the difference between that and a harpsichord?
Well, the harpsichord plucks the strings with plectra, in this case made out of quills from ravens at the Tower of London, whereas the piano uses small hammers with leather or felt.
Can we actually see how this works?
Yes, of course. Well, this is a jack. It sits on the end of the key. As you depress the key, the jack rises and the plectra here plucks the string. And then on the return journey, because it's in a hinged tongue, it slips back past the string and the damper there just damps the sound, stops it vibrating.
What do we know about Frederick, Prince of Wales' interests in music?
Well, from the Mercier portrait, he's clearly playing a cello sonata, and he was also a patron of opera and had his own opera company, the Opera of the Nobility. And that was the last musical director of that was Giovanni Battista Beschetti. It was a rival to Handel's opera, which was supported by George II, so it was very much a rival outfit.
So if you were going to demonstrate it at its best, what sort of music would you use? That's very singing kind of, sort of tone.
Very, and it harks back, I think, to lute music and the sort of arpeggiated texture and so on. So that can bring out a more gentle and expressive quality that, again, the singing quality this instrument has.
Frederick, Prince of Wales, wanted to be a player in the London political scene as well as a future monarch. And in order to do this, he needed to maintain himself and his court in a lavish style. But he also needed to demonstrate that he had serious, well-informed, and up-to-date taste in the arts.
Here at the National Maritime Museum, we can see Frederick's biggest purchase. It says a lot about how he wanted people to see him.
This is Frederick, Prince of Wales's barge. This is your statement object. You're really having an opportunity to show off here. So, I mean, that's exactly why he designed it like this.
But you've got to share the space with all comers. There's no royal lane.
Indeed. The River Thames was used by hundreds of small boats, large boats.
How does it work?
So you had these cross seats and then 21 oars operated by the same number of oarsmen. And then behind it you had the cabin where Frederick and his guests would have been seated. And then behind that the barge master, who's the driver, using the tiller to steer the boat.
What does this tell us about Frederick, Prince of Wales' patronage of the arts?
Well, this is thanks really to William Kent, who's the great genius of design of this age. And he's taken various kind of areas of various objects of classical symbolism, like the shell, for instance, and obviously here you have this Vitruvian scroll in the form of a wave. So these all have a very, very clear naval symbolism. And then curiously, you have some oak swags, which of course are not particularly associated with the sea, but of course the whole piece is made from oak. But I think what's very interesting about this is really the way it's designed, because of course it's a boat, but it's conceived as a piece of architecture. And so if you look up here, you've got this amazing truss here, which is turned into a sea monster. I mean, you could never do that on a building.
So you tear up the rule book with a boat.
Exactly, and this is where he really went to town and did a fantastic job.
In 1751, Frederick, Prince of Wales, died, and we will never know what the reign of Frederick I would have been like. Some hints are provided by the reign of George III, Frederick's son, who certainly took from his father ideas about the encouragement of science and learning.